I would like to announce that this meeting is being recorded, if there is anyone else in attendance. I know SAR is here, right, Alex? Anyone else? Okay, thank you. First order of business is the Pledge of Allegiance.
Take your hat off.
Yeah, right.
I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America,
and to the republic for which it stands,
one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
If we can remain standing, please. I know it's been a while since we've had our last meeting, and usually when we do stand, it's in because of something that's sad that's happened in our country. But this time, it's about triumph and glory and excitement as far as, I don't know if anybody's been watching the Olympics. But I mean, no, well, you should watch the Olympics. You know, we talk about our country and countries coming together. And I think the games down in Rio have been very good, a lot of coverage, good coverage by NBC. And I just think that I've been watching it and I've been inspired by, you know, you think about your child and the parents' support and the support of coaches to where our athletes are. I mean, the United States, we should be commended on how well we're doing in Rio. We got the most medals. You know, so a lot of times we look that our country is not as good and this and that, and we are like 50 medals ahead of everyone down in the Olympics. So with that, my hats go off to Team USA, and that's why this is here. So I just want to congratulate our players and athletes and their families for the Olympics. So yeah, round of applause. Yay. And with that, I have some gold medals. This is for Team Somerset.
You were too much.
And you know, for all of us doing such a good job, I have our own little medals to give. Only from me. Clem, I don't know where you are.
It says
that is real. No, it's real gold. Real gold. So you can put them out for all doing a good job, because if we were in the Olympics as a town.
Can we sit down now?
Yes, we
and get
can
to
sit
business.
Down. Let's get to business.
Okay.
But thank you for being gold medalists.
Those praises for the Olympics. How come you never said nothing about the three guys that got robbed over there?
No, I understand that. But you know, there's all negative to some stuff. I'm trying to hit on the positive for one, and that's what we want to do here. So thank you, Mr. Brown, for that. But all positive stuff. Okay. I'd like to call a motion to waive the reading of the minutes of July 13th, 2016 from the meeting of the Somerset Board of Selectmen as approved and circulated.
So moved.
Second.
By roll call vote, Mr. Motis?
Aye.
By Ms. McNamara?
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. We do have a 6:05 appointment, Mr. James O'Rourke, he's the chairman of the Community Preservation Committee. I know he is here with the presentation, so no further ado, Mr. O'Rourke, come on up, please.
One thing I did want to correct. I'm here as chairman of the Historical Commission. That's a typo.
Okay.
If you look later on in new business, you'll see that's corrected.
Okay.
Correctly indicated.
But you're actually on both, though, aren't you?
I am, but I'm.
You're not in this capacity
this is nothing
tonight.
Nothing today.
Nothing to do from the CP, the CPA.
CPA.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you for that clarification.
Two matters. One is the Village District, and the other one is the Old Town Hall. I'm going to begin with the Village District. I only have a few minutes, and if there's any questions, I'll try to answer them. The Historical Commission has taken a vote, and we're requesting the support of the Board of Selectmen to initiate the nomination process for the placement of the Village District on the National Register of Historic Places. And that will include the solicitation of grant money to employ a preservation planning consultant to prepare the nomination application. Now that begs the question, why do we want the Board of Selectmen's support? Well, in order to get on the National Register, you have to go through the Massachusetts Historical Commission. The director of the National Historic District Program has told me specifically that we have to get the permission of the Board of Selectmen as a first step in applying for nomination to the National Register. Question, why should the town want Village District put on the National Register? First of all, it's prestigious. There's 900 National Historic Districts in Massachusetts. Nearby communities have taken advantage of the designation. Swansea has five districts. I've had them for, I think, going back to the 2000s. Berkeley has just obtained a designation for its common district this year. There are federal tax credits which are available for substantial rehabilitation of income-producing and commercial property. So there's a benefit there for income-producing property. And properties in the district become eligible for matching state grants for restoration of properties owned by nonprofit organizations or the town. So the town could apply for matching state grants if in fact it becomes a national district. Why not? What is the downside of it? Well, I don't think there is one. First of all, the placement is honorary only. There's no, and this is, needs to be emphasized, there's no federal or state agency, that is, no federal or state agency can restrict what a property owner chooses to do with their property in the district. The property owner can make changes in any buildings they own without getting any permission from the state or federal government. This is not a local historic district, which some communities have. That's not what we're asking for. This is a national historic district, which does not restrict the use of the properties. We are not asking for any money from the town in order to go through this eligibility, through this nomination process. Because there were prior thorough investigations and reports done, paid by CERPID and partially by the town in 1988 and 2006, there's been very thorough reports, and they all say that the town, that the village is eligible to be placed in the National Historic District if you just go through the nomination process. We need, though, to update it from 2006. So we got 10 years. We have to show that there hasn't been a great diminution in those valuable pieces of historic properties that are in the district. That's what he's supposed to do, or she's supposed to do. They have gotten some prices, and they say approximately $10,000. And maybe as much as $12,000 is all that would be needed to update the 2006 report to the present time, complete the nomination papers, and submit them to the Massachusetts Historical Commission. Now, if this board were to support the nomination process, that doesn't mean that the people in the village will not have a say on it. Quite to the contrary. This is a process. So what happens is, once the nomination is filed with the Massachusetts Historical Commission, and if they think it's in order, then they will send out to all of the property owners within the proposed district and give them a date and tell them, look, if you don't want it, you can file an objection. And then, But to defeat the nomination, more than 50% of the property owners must object. Okay, so there has to be, people have to come forward, either come to the hearing date, I believe it's in Boston, or submit a notarized letter indicating that they object to the nomination. It then goes, if in fact there is not an objection, then it goes ahead to the feds, and the percentage, if the recommendation is from the Massachusetts Historical Commission to allow the district, then the National Parks goes through, National Park Service goes through the nomination forms. The percentage of Massachusetts nominations is 95%, so there's a very, very good chance that if we get the nomination through the Massachusetts process, then it will be becoming a national historic. The properties in that district will be placed in the National Historic Register. So I don't know if there's any questions.
Why would the people object?
No idea. Well, some people, one of the things that I already mentioned is people confuse the National Historic District with a local historic district. Local historic districts have a review process, so that if you want to change your house, you've got to get the permission of this committee, a review committee. Fall River has, in the Highlands, has an area that's a local historic, and they ran into some problems this year or the end of last year with respect to that, and they didn't notify people, and there was an issue with that. Westport Point, for instance, you know, they have a local historic district down there. But again, people say, oh, we don't want that. We don't want anybody telling me I can't add to my property. That's right. Well, I can't, you know, if I want purple paint on the outside, you know, you can't do that.
So Mr. O'Rourke, so that's not going to happen. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but in a national registered district, so people who do live within the district will still be allowed to do what they want.
Exactly.
And certain properties, the individual properties themselves, would only be either on the history or...
No, the whole district.
The whole district. There. But some houses may not conform to the... They may not be part of the
but
register.
But there's no restriction. Anybody in the district, whether it's a 1723 piece of property, and we do have a house up there that old, or whether it's a relatively recent construction that happens to be in the historic district, anybody can do what they want with the property. As I said, it's honorary.
Right. And with this nomination or the support of this board, you're able to put it on the National Register as well as solicit, obviously, grant money so that we can preserve it. And it would also be CPA money as well? Not
well,
just grant money?
We,
or is that considered
well,
kind
we
of
haven't,
the
well, well, first of all, it's only $10,000. Right now, we would like to be able to, this CERPID, I've spoken to people at CERPID, and then there's certain mini-grants that might total up to $10,000 so that we wouldn't have to wait. You know, being on the CPA committee, it's going to take until next summer before any money would be free. My hope is that we could get the money before that and use it to get the process going, to get the preservationist working, to get the nomination papers in. But all I'm asking is that the town support the process, and the process doesn't leave out the people that live in the district. They are going to be notified of this, and if there is a majority, if 51% of the people up there say that they don't want it,
it won't
that's
happen.
The end of it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So they have some protection, and you guys are not, so to speak, voting for the village. You're not taking the place of the village. All you're saying is the process can go ahead, okay? And the process means we finish off the application process, we present it to Mass Housing, and then Mass Historical will then send out the notices and to the homeowners and say, look, do you have any objection? If not, then this will go ahead to the National Park Service, and based upon the numbers, it will be allowed.
Oh, I have a question.
Go ahead, Steve.
What is the delineation of the waterfront? Where are you looking? What's the area that you're looking to encompass?
That's a good question. I know one of the things that I looked at was the inventory form that was done in 2006 said, as part of this final nomination process, you're going to have to, we're going to have to pinpoint certain properties and where the boundaries are going to be. I mean, I can tell you, you've got Euclid Avenue. Now, that's not to say if it's on the south side of Euclid that it's not going to be in the district. I think you have to put in like Bristol Marine, because that was the Mount Hope, that's one of the most historic pieces of property in town. So you got Euclid Avenue, but basically you've got High Street, both sides of High Street. You've got Main Street, both sides, again, to the river and then up the hill. And then Old Colony. Now, Old Colony Avenue would be the end, but it only goes up to Pleasant Street. So there's part of Old Colony, if you've got into the history at all, you know Old Colony is named after the railroad, and that Old Colony used to go all the way down to the river. They used to have coal. They used to have trains down there. That is now a subdivision. So that would not really and shouldn't be included in the historic district. Okay, so those are basically the gives you a sense of the boundaries. Now, once this preservation gets in to wrap this up, he's going to check, you know, to see if some some properties, perhaps maybe on the borderline, have been destroyed or are no longer conforming, and he may pull it back a little bit. But I doubt very much if it will change from what I just said. So Euclid Avenue on the south, Old Colony on the north, High Street both sides, maybe to the Palmer Street area to some extent, because you got the very historic Palmer, mm-hmm. Palmer Street Cemetery. And then, of course, you've got down the hill to Main Street and into the river. Right.
So this would be part of your process for your paperwork that you would submit as part of this nomination process?
Right.
So they have an actual visual of what they're going to be voting for?
Right. Right. Now, the other thing, too, is I urge people, if they have access to the Internet, it's called Macris, M-A-C-R-I-S, and you can get on there and look at the 2006 study. I have a copy here. It's very, very thorough. It tells you a lot about the town, a lot about historic properties, about the process, and it has a map in there. It has a list of all of the properties. If I can take a look, I can tell you how many properties there are. I had to take off my shoes to count all the properties, but
so you said the village residents actually have a say. You were mentioning the 51%.
Right.
How are you folks going to arrange that? Are you going to have like a meeting somewhere for the folks to voice their concerns, or is this part of this entire giant
process? This is all done by the Massachusetts Historical. Once we file the nomination, if the papers are in place, after we have our preservationist bring the 2006 study up to snuff, he files it. If they feel that he's completed it properly, then they will schedule a hearing, and they will then send out notices to all of the homeowners. They can take care of that, not the historical commission, not you people, not the town. This is done by the historical commission. They will get a list of all of the property owners. I assume they will take it off our assessor's list, and they won't be doing title exams to see if somebody's passed it. But I have 218 properties is listed. Now, some of them, though, they list, we have historic wharfs, we have other historic properties that are not, strictly speaking, we have walls, and there's even a map that they show here which shows the historic areas.
Do you have
but
any
they
other
list
questions?
Each one of these properties in there.
I'm sorry.
No,
do you have any questions?
Yeah, no, I think it would be an honor to be on the National Register. I think so. It sounds like you're looking for us to support the process, and in doing so, you'll map out where it goes and the state will take it from there.
That's yep. right. That's right. That's yep. part of the nomination. Our expert yeah. will have to pinpoint those properties, because if he doesn't pinpoint exactly, then Mass Historical Commission won't know who to notify. They have to get an exact list of the of all of the homeowners that are within the district, the proposed district.
Yeah, I think that's okay. great.
One other question, Cheryl, can you speak loudly or come up? Either one. Yeah, I just want to make sure everyone at home can listen to what you have to say. You can share the podium with Mr. O'Rourke, if that's okay.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry.
She just wants to ask you a question, I believe.
I have three, actually. I happen to be a property owner in the village. Mm-hmm. And so from 2008 till now, history started yesterday. What properties, if it's the whole district, when does the history start?
Well, the history, I'm not sure I understand.
Well, you had Indians living there back in historical times, and yeah. Pilgrim owned property like mine a long time ago. But if it's an historic district, I can understand if something was, built a long time ago, but even the McMansions today were built yesterday maybe or something, and they would be now historic. So I'm wondering about the definition. That's one. Another is that when the street down on Main Street was narrowed, mm-hmm. and lights, beautiful lights were put in and beautiful sidewalks put in, one of the things that residents, we all found out was that everybody's property is a little bit off. When the town looked into what was what, like, for example, the fellow to the south of me has a carport that that's partly on the property of the person, you know, next to that. So everybody was a little bit off, and I believe you'll find the same thing on High Street. So that's something to keep in mind if people are just looking at charts rather than, you know, really checking what's going on. We found out we were all on other people's properties, and there's still a lot of misunderstanding. So I wanted to make sure that that was looked into. And
well,
there's not
going to be any surveys. They're not going to survey.
Well, that's what I mean. It was surveyed, so you're not entirely sure where those lines are. So just to let you know that, that's what was found out when the street, when the town had the surveys done. The other thing is, if, you know, even in gated communities and a lot of places where you, in communities where you buy properties today, there are restrictions on what you can do, plants you can put up and so forth. If there are to be no restrictions, what's really the purpose? I'm not really clear on that. I've been reading about this in the paper, and I don't object to it per se. I'm just wondering about those things. What would actually be the purpose?
Well, I try to answer that by saying, first of all, it's honorary.
I know, but what's the, but there's a...
Well, there are some, income producing properties there, and there is tax credits that are available to those people. It might even extend, I'm not sure of this, but it might even extend to Bristol Marine. If somebody owns income property up there, in other words, they multifamilies, and they want to do a substantial rehabilitation, and they want to do it historically accurate, then they can apply for tax credits. I believe it's like 20%, state and federal. So that's an advantage. The other advantage is nonprofit organizations that may be there. Again, I don't know who they would be. But the town has properties down there. They could also apply, certainly not for tax credits, but for grant money from the state.
Okay, excuse me, Mr. O'Rourke, because I think a lot of this, Cheryl, I think they're good questions, but I think, like Mr. O'Rourke mentioned, there will be a public hearing, and
I think those would be
good questions to bring to them.
But he wants an approval for you, and
we're just going to say yes, maybe no to the process. We're not saying yes that it's definitely going to happen. Mr. O'Rourke is looking for this board to say to look further with the process of applying, and I think all those questions, like he mentioned, they will be sent out to each individual. They'll have a public hearing, and if you've got the majority that say yes, then you go with it. So I think all of your questions would be better suited for that.
It just seems to me that's kind of backwards. I mean, this seems like an opportunity to at least bring it up.
Yeah, you can bring it up, but
I don't
think we have...
Because you like the information, instead of having to make a point of saying no, you know, if we know in advance what it is. For example, if your house was built in 1932, must you build it, and you wanted substantial rehabilitation, do you have to build it without air conditioning?
I don't think we have those answers, but I think the general idea is...
But there's got to be a purpose, and I have yet, you know, the fact where it's honorary, it's historic, I don't understand. There's got to be an actual purpose for it.
Well, if I could speak. So it's not even on the table yet, so it's pointless for us to even ask these questions until we allow him to pursue it, and then the questions can come later.
But I'm not sure they're going to come back here. I don't want to miss
No.
They might not, but they'll have that opportunity later. Yeah.
So I think, Cheryl, I just think you should keep those.
Yeah.
But I don't see the point. I mean,
well, because we just got to think of the idea as a good idea or not, whether we go forth or not.
That's what I'm trying to figure out, because I actually live in the village.
No,
and
I understand.
And it won't affect your survey lines. It's not going to affect.
No, but what is the point? That's what
I think the point is like he mentioned, is that we will be able to get funding to keep certain historic buildings up to snuff and keep them restored.
One of the things is the fire bond, and it couldn't go on by itself, and that's included in this.
That'll be included in the district.
Right. The whole thing, it's a district. They're not going to go and...
It's not individual.
Look at everyone's house.
Right.
It's not like the inventory.
Right.
It's just the whole district.
So I think, is there any other discussion from anybody? Okay.
I've submitted those a proposed motion.
Right, and I'm going to read that now. So with no further discussion, I am going to call for a motion that the Board of Selectmen hereby agree to support the efforts of the Somerset Historical Commission to initiate the nomination process for the placement of the Somerset Village District on the National Register of Historic Places, including the solicitation of grant money to employ a preservation planning consultant to prepare the nomination application.
So moved.
Second.
By roll call vote, Mr. Moniz?
Aye.
Ms. McNamara?
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. Thank you, Mr. O'Rourke.
Okay, thank you.
And I...
That's number one.
Oh.
I got to go through the second one now.
Okay.
The second one has to do with the Old Town Hall. The Historical Commission, through grant money, had a feasibility study for an exterior restoration of the Somerset Old Town Hall. That feasibility study, Selectmen have a copy. There is a copy that is online. It's under the Historical Commission section of the Somerset website. It's available for everyone to see. What we're looking for, the Historical Commission is requesting that the board agree to support the efforts of the Historical Commission to rehabilitate the Old Town Hall per the recommendations set forth in the feasibility study, including the solicitation of grant money to pay for the rehabilitation. We're not asking, you know, for money out of the town's budget. We're going to try and do this with grant money. Some of that grant money may be through applications for CPA funds. I say some. We don't know at this point. Just to remind people, the building is, if you all know, it's a building right kind of in back of this wall. The building was constructed in 1873. It was constructed on the site of the first town hall. It has an architectural style that's been described as Greek Revival and Italianate, which coincidentally is what a lot of the old buildings are down in the village. Thing is, you wouldn't know that, because in 1976, something had to be done to the exterior, and a decision was made at that time to put aluminum siding and install that on the Old Town Hall. The effect of that was to give the surfaces a flattened look. It doesn't have any texture. It doesn't have any of the detailing that the old building had. And hopefully those details are underneath the aluminum siding. To some extent, our consultant who prepared the study did get under and look at some of the clapboards and detail underneath. And he said there still may be some there that we can use. But it's also apparent that when they did this in 1976, that they weren't doing it in an historically authentic way. And what we want to do now is to do it the right way. In the past, first of all, 40 years, aluminum siding has kind of an end date of 25 to 40 years. There's problems now with the aluminum siding, not any defect in the aluminum siding itself, but cars have been hitting, particularly on the south side of the building, have been hitting and denting all along the base of the aluminum siding. Bonnie Mendes happened to tell me today, I noticed that there was a discoloration on the north side, and I guess quite some time ago there was some graffiti, and there was an attempt to take care of it, but if you go out there now, you'll see that it's all discolored. So we may be looking at, you know, whether we do it in a historic, authentic way or some other way, we may be looking at having to do some work on the exterior of the Old Town Hall. And the Old Town Hall, unlike, for instance, say, the Quaker Meeting House at this time, is used frequently. I went by there today at 5 o'clock, and there were people using it. It's used at night. It's used by a lot of nonprofits. It's a real community resource, and therefore we should preserve it.
So So, once again, Mr. O'Rourke, though, so this building, once again, you're saying would not be, you know, funded through tax money at all. It would be through grant money.
That's right.
And through, if maybe some money from the CPA, which typically is, that's one of the purposes of the CPA is to.
That's correct.
Okay. So is there any other further discussion from my board members on this matter? No. So with no further discussion, I'm going to call for a motion, if that's okay, Mr. O'Rourke.
There's just one other thing I wanted to mention, too, and that is one of the things I mentioned in the report, and I'll be brief, is the cupola. There's a cupola that was on the top of the old town hall. It was destroyed more than 40 years ago. And we've got a price. We have various options within the feasibility study, and one of them is to replace for $15,000 to $17,000 the cupola. And I think it will give the building a great deal of historical authenticity, and we should try to do that again if we can get the grant money to do that. Okay.
Okay. Thank you. All right. So with that, I will call for a motion that the Board of Selectmen hereby agree to support the efforts of the Somerset Historical Commission to rehabilitate the Old Town Hall per the recommendations set forth in the feasibility study for the exterior restoration of the Somerset Old Town Hall dated May 2nd, 2016, including the solicitation of grant money to pay for the rehabilitation.
So moved.
Second.
By roll call vote, Mr. Moniz?
Aye.
By Ms. McNamara?
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. Thank you, Mr. O'Rourke.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good luck in your future endeavors. Okay, we do have an appointment, 6:20. Sorry, Chief. We are a little bit backed up, but appreciate you being here. And
let's go. That's okay. I miss you guys. I haven't seen you.
I know. I haven't seen you in a while either. It's nice to see you. How's everything going? Good.
How are you?
Yes.
I haven't seen you in years, it seems.
Does that mean?
No, it's okay.
Stick down.
By the way, that could become a Pokemon stop if it's historical.
What?
So you know.
Oh,
what?
Oh really?
God.
Yeah.
Main Street.
No.
Jim was just talking
Let's
about
not even think
become
about
a Pokemon stop.
Oh, Pokemon.
Just so you know. Anyway, I don't want to put anything on that. So here for a couple different things. First, I want to say while I'm out here in public and on TV is to say that if for those of you who haven't signed up for nextdoor.com, please do. I do a weekly newsletter. I've been doing it. I'm in my 15th week now doing it. Everybody seems to like it. We're 13% of the households in the community are now signed up for Nextdoor, close to 1,300 people, 978 households. So everybody seems to like the newsletter. I try to give as much pertinent information as to what's going on in the town. Some of the more important calls we went to in the past week, that's there every week. So, and it just so the secret, just if you Google it, you can find it that way too. But I shouldn't tell you that because I just gave it away. But nextdoor.com, sign up for it because you can interact with your neighbors about things in your neighborhood that might be of issue to all of you. So it's a good thing to sign up for. It's easy to do. So a couple things I'm here for tonight. One is the cruiser use fee, and we've since 2009 we've had a usage fee for cruisers for police details of $10 per hour. And 2009 was the last correspondence I could see with the selectmen that there was a fee. I think Richard, we talked about that. And I couldn't find any historical data or anything like that. I did find a letter from Captain Solomito dated 2009 that was asking for a $10 fee per hour for cruiser usage. I find that since I've been here in the past couple of years that police cruisers are used a lot on details and they're idling all day long. The fee has not been increased. I did a survey of 15 communities, including Rhode Island and Massachusetts, all the way up to Taunton, all the way down to Pawtucket, and Warren. Warren's has the highest. They're $25 per hour with an 18% administrative fee. So my recommendation is that we go up to $25 per hour. Because, I mean, I'll give you an example. This past few weeks, there's been a company just paving roads. I'm talking roads that are 100 yards long, two cruisers on each end, side of the street. Why do we need two cars there? We just saw horses, but they wanted them. We gave them to them. We charged them $10 per hour. Well, how about if we charge you $25 per hour? So they'll probably still want them, but mm-hmm. The town, the police department, we can make more money off of that. So I think I don't think it's going to curb anything. I think they're still going to request police cars on police details. But as you know, the fleet's getting older. The Crown Vics are getting old. There's a couple of them that I want to decommission, take off patrol, just use strictly for details. We can just We're going to use this cruiser and that cruiser just for details. They're not going to be on patrol anymore. So if we do that, I think we see some benefits going down the road. So I think that would be, that's a recommendation from me. I discussed it with the administrator. He thinks it's a good idea. So I think that would be great if the board would vote to increase that fee to $25 per hour.
So, Chief, is 25 like the going number, or is it closer?
Yeah, it varies. Some towns are 15, some are 20, some are 25.
The highest is 25.
Some have a flat rate. They'll say, you know, we want $80, we want $200. Some have a flat rate.
Yep.
Some have no, have zero. But
it just goes along with.
But their detail rate is really high.
Yeah.
So you know, you'd like Taunton, they don't have a fee, but their detail rate's $52 an hour. So, you know, it gets a give and take.
Okay.
So I would say that that would make sense for us to do that.
Where would this put us in comparison to the other communities?
We'd be we'd be right up there. We'd be up near Warren and Pawtucket. Pawtucket and Warren around 20, 25. So, but we're not asking for an additional administrative fee. We're just doing the straight 25. We still have a 10% administrative on every detail that's out there, just to administrate, you know, to process the detail. But there's no additional fee on top of the 25. It's just a straight $25 an hour.
That's reasonable.
Yeah, I think so. Okay. With no further discussion, I will call for a motion that we change the fee of charging the $10 for a police cruiser to $25 per hour as of, when can we do this, tomorrow?
I put a date of September 5th.
Oh, you did? Okay.
Just so we can send the notices out to the contractors.
Okay. So, September 5th would be the start date, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
By roll call vote, Mr. Motors?
Aye.
Ms. McNamara?
Aye.
I vote aye as well.
Okay, the second thing is probably a positive thing, as was the first. So we had the one of the detective's vehicles went down in July. Can't be repaired. The DPW won't put the money into it. It needs a transmission. Probably needs a new engine. So it's been decommissioned. So Detective David's has been dispatched to drive a old Crown Vic that's black, and he can't do much surveillance and detective work in it because it's an old black Crown Vic with lights on it and stuff. So we're out one car. A couple of the other ones are getting up there, 100,000-mile range. And the expense of the DPW is getting up there, too. As a letter I submitted to you guys on August 8th, the expenditure on the cruise, on two of the cruises, are getting up there, $5,000, $5,200, just in parts. That doesn't include the time, the labor, and all that. Over the past couple of years, has really gone up there. So, as I said before, regarding the details, I'd like to commit a couple of these cruises just to details and not take them off patrol so the guys aren't dealing with these vehicles in case they're in a pursuit or they have to go to a scene quickly. The wear and tear and the stress on these vehicles, it becomes. Can become, a problem. So, having that in mind, there is a resident that stepped up and said, "I'll kick in $20,000 if you'll lease a couple of vehicles." So I said, "We'll take it." And so I looked into a lease option, a lease to purchase option, and it come to find out that a lot of towns do this, and it actually cuts down the expense of actually, you know, spending $38,000 to $40,000 for a, you know, an Explorer or whatever. Every year or 2 years. So they lease them with a purchased option to purchase it at the end. They don't have to. They can just say, well, we don't want it anymore. So looking into it, I found a couple of different agencies that had them. They're all on the state bid list. They're either Plymouth County or the Mass state bid list. And they had them. For instance, Freetown, Chief Abbott in Freetown, he leases his. He's been leasing his for years. He's just started leasing all Dodge Chargers because he says that they're getting good reviews now that a couple of years ago they weren't. They're all-wheel drive now. So I looked into that, and we found a company. I actually looked around. Ford's lease rates were high. I found one that was down under 2% for a lease rate. We could actually lease two vehicles a year for $9,918, two vehicles. And actually, sticker price is about $70,000. We're getting them for about $50,000 to $52,000, so we're getting really good prices on the vehicles. The lease price is $99.18 per year. Obviously, we only have to be concerned about this first year going forward, but we have enough money in the account for 2 years. I think the only concern right now is, you know, we approve this and we get the vehicles in our garage and we outfit them and get them on the road. And we have detective has a a new vehicle, and then the fleet has a new, they're going to have a new Dodge Charger, which is going to be for primarily for traffic enforcement, but it will be used for patrol as well. It'll be a Dodge Charger with ghost lettering on it, which means it'll be subdued letters, no light bar. It'll be great for, you know, speeding and doing those surveillance stuff at night and that sort of thing. So I think, and I've already looked into them, I've been pricing things and going to different places over the past couple months. Mm-hmm. And when this person gave us the $20,000, I said, well, let's see if the selectmen like it. And going forward, I actually reached out to another association to see if they could help us. They said, yeah, we can probably give you some money too. That won't be till next month, but I anticipate we're going to get a good
this
chunk
of
change.
Is all legal, what you're doing? do we actually have $20,000? Did they actually give it to you already, or is it contingent?
It's in a donation account. Yep.
What happens if you say no?
It's already there.
I have a couple of questions. I think it's a great idea. You said you have funding for the first 2 years?
Yes.
Now, I saw in your correspondence that you were going to be looking at pursuing grants.
Yep.
And receiving additional donations. Is it, I mean, we're talking 2 years out. I understand that.
Yes.
But how certain are you with receiving monies through grants? I mean, I just don't want to say, yeah, it is a great idea.
If I gave you a percentage, I would say, I would say 90.
We come 2 years down the road.
But even 2 years down the line, even, I mean, the expense budget's really low right now. If I came to you guys in 2 years and said, hey, I need another 10 grand in the expense budget, it's better than saying, hey, I need 76,000 or 40,000 or whatever to maintain these leases. So I think going down the road, it's going to save us a heck of a lot of money going forward. Just ask for an extra $10,000 on my expense account just to pay for the leases.
You may not even need to ask for that.
And you may not have to. But you may, you know, you may, but I anticipate we won't, because I anticipate some of these people that are donating money are going to continue to, because they're just such great philanthropists, and they care so much about our community. They mm-hmm. contribute every year.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not
this
just
person
one
has done
person.
Before.
Yes, but there's other people too.
Yeah,
I mean, there's another woman that gave me $10,000 for Jared's canine. She just kept sending checks at Christmas time for $5,000. So, I mean, you get people like that donating it, which is gonna. And I mean, Jillian Sports Pub is doing a public safety charity event for us at the end of August, and they're going to donate a portion of their proceeds to us, which is going to go into this account. So,
and you'll have those 2 years to build up. Sounds like.
Yep.
Yeah.
And I plan on focusing everything on just going to that account so we can fund it going forward.
I know I don't want to see us stuck.
No, I didn't. I didn't either. The other thing too, Steve, is if we ran into an issue where we didn't have the money, we could say, take them back, take the cars back.
Yeah.
You can do that. You can just
now, how
say,
long does it take when you get the vehicles to get it all outfitted, as you mentioned?
That's the reason why I researched, because I wanted to make sure these things were on the ground in a lot, and they are. Mm-hmm. They're there. One of them I've already seen with my own eyes, so it's there. The other one's in Plymouth. It's on the ground. It's there. It takes a little bit of time. We're going to have Firefighter Coster, who was can outfit cars. He's going to help us out with that, and we're going to, you know, as soon as it's approved, we send them a check, and we get the VINs. We can register them, bring them here. They'll be in our lot. They won't be in Marlboro. They'll mm-hmm. be here, and then we can start outfitting them. So I would say about a month, which is better than 6 months, because the first few vehicles I got, it took almost 7 months to get them because of all the red tape. With them.
Is the lettering and all the decal work done local here somewhere?
I was contemplating contracting someone who does it inexpensively and does a lot of us, and they used to do our cruises prior to me being here, when Chief Ferrer was here and Chief Smith.
Yeah.
And I'm probably going to go to them because they're inexpensive and they can do it in a half an hour.
Oh, wow.
So, 40 minutes.
Wow.
Yes. Okay, I don't have any other questions.
Yeah. Richard, do you have...
I was just going to point out that, remember during the budget process, we had a capital improvement list, and actually replacing two police cruisers was something that was requested in the capital plan. We did not have a method of funding that at the time. So it's encouraging that we have a method of funding it. We have a method of funding it for the next couple of years. Worst case scenario, the contributions don't come in, the amount of payment is a modest part of the operating expense, as opposed to what would be, you know, the replacement of two frontline vehicles. So I think it's a great opportunity for us to go forward. And to answer the chairman's question, yes, it is legal. We are procuring off of the state bid list. We do accept donations and gifts, and we put them into a gift account. Once they get into that account, they are treated as municipal funds, and we react accordingly when we expend them.
Yeah. No, I mean, I was being kind of funny.
No, I know what
you know that. But what I'd like
I
to do
I just wanted to clarify that.
Yeah,
in
no.
case.
Thank you. Thank you, Richard. But I also want to commend these individuals, because I know there's a lot of people in this town that do give of themselves,
a lot
whether
of
it's just yeah. volunteer and
it's
effort.
It's not just one or two people.
No, I know it's not. And I know who the individuals are, and it's great, and we actually entice more people to do what these individuals are doing, because, you know, it's really nice that you can, you know, some people can afford to do this. It really does help us out, and we do appreciate it. So I'd like to acknowledge those people, even though they want to stay anonymous. So, no further discussion?
Nope.
Okay, I am going to call for a motion that we enter into the lease purchase of the police vehicles, two of them. One of them is a 2016 Dodge Charger, and one is a 2016 Ford Explorer, as documented in the lease program by the chief.
So moved.
Second.
My roll call.
As
yes.
part of that. It was to authorize town administrator to sign any paperwork
yes.
that goes along with this.
Yes, any other paperwork that needs to be done by a procurement officer, which is Mr. Richard Brown.
So moved.
Second.
By roll call vote, Mr. Morris?
Aye.
By Ms. McNamara?
Aye.
And I vote aye as well.
Thank you.
Good job, Chief.
Congrats.
Good job,
great.
Chief.
Good
appreciate it. Okay. All righty. Why don't we move right to the top here?
Get
we need
to
what? Yeah, yeah. The side of the warrant. This is just a protocol that we sign the warrant for the 2016 state primary. So I'm going to call for a motion, unless there's any discussion.
No.
Okay. Call for a motion that we sign the warrant for the 2016 state primary
so
as
moved.
Circulated.
So moved.
Signing the bottom.
Second.
Second.
By roll call vote, Mr. Moniz.
Aye.
Ms.
Aye.
McMahon. Aye. And I vote aye as well. And by the way, the date for that is September 8th, 2016. And as you know, all precincts will be voting at the Somerset Berkeley Regional High School Student Dining Center.
Oh my God.
I was going to, out of respect. Why, you don't mind if I continue? Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you, Mr. Moniz. Why don't we move on? We are up to vote to extend for 1 year the intermunicipal agreement with the town of Swansea for the administration of shared alternate building inspector, local inspector services. Basically, this is for our building department, mostly our building inspector, that we share in case one inspector is out, the other will fills in. And this is an agreement that we had last year. Clem, do you want to chime in?
It's really a total of 3 years, but it has to be renewed each
every year.
Last year was the first year.
So the two boards have to agree to extend it for one more year, and then next year you'll get the opportunity to do it again.
I mean, once again, this is where we partner with different communities. I mean, I know I'm all for it, and it's worked well. I mean, this way here, when the building inspector takes a vacation, our guy fills in for him. If we have an emergency, then their inspector will fill in for us, and it works well. Everybody works together, you get, you know, better results. So any further discussion on this?
Nope.
So I will call for a motion that we extend for 1 year the intermunicipal agreement with the town of Swansea for the administration of the shared alternate building inspector, local inspector services.
So moved.
Second.
By roll call vote, Mr. Moniz?
Aye.
By Ms. McNamara?
Aye.
I vote aye as well. Next order of business is the Board of Health to vote to increase the town nurse's hours. I can speak on it, but Clem, yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah.
Richard, either one of you guys, if you want.
I'll take this one. First. We have a shared employment agreement with Swansea for the nurse. They've revised that agreement to provide that it's going to be 20 hours. I believe the last one was 35. Mm-hmm. And because that's a change from the prior agreement, you have to agree that it's that you're along going along with the going up to 40 hours. I believe you've talked to the chair or.
Yes, and essentially they're going to, the town nurse will continue to do what she's been doing in the past, splitting her time between our town and the town of Swansea. It's a different circumstance in Swansea where we have the town nurse's office is located right at the Council on Aging, which is great for the seniors that are there. I spoke to our town nurse, and she says that she, on bingo days, she gets a lot of traffic in there for blood pressure and cholesterol screening, which is great. People know that she's there. She's been well received. People seem to like her and her services. So that's what will continue to happen.
And that's the only change.
Right. I was
the intermunicipal agreement remains in effect.
Right.
It's just that it originally called for a 35-hour week, and they're now proposing that it go to 40.
Holly, do you have anything for that? Okay. So with that, I will call for motion that we will just, yes, contract stays the same. Nothing is changing except we are voting just to increase the town nurse's hours to 40 hours a week.
So moved.
Second.
By roll call vote, Mr. Moniz?
Aye.
Ms. McNamara?
Aye.
I vote aye as well. Okay, moving right along. Next is to appoint assistant to the Council on Aging Director. In case you don't know, we've had the Susan, who was the assistant, had retired, and she has moved on to better things, and I want to thank her. I know she came with a lot of experience, and she brought a lot to the Council on Aging, so we wish her well in her future endeavors. So that left that spot open, and the Council on Aging has done due diligence as far as who they recommend. There were applications and interviews. Richard, right, you have all gone through this?
Yeah, I'd just like to, please, for the record, say that the board has delegated that process to me rather than the board interviewing the candidates for the assistant to the director. Part of that process was the board in its process interviewing, doing the screening, accepting applications, doing the screening, and interviewing applications. They received 20 applications. They interviewed a number of them. They had a group of finalists. They were presented at a public meeting of the Council on Aging. and as a result of that presentation at the meeting, they determined that Shauna Gary was the most appropriate for that position and forwarded that information to me, asking that you, as the appointing authority, appoint her as the assistant to the director.
Thank you. Any further discussion on that, Mr. Moniz?
No, I see that we have the director here and a couple of members of the board on the Council of Aging. I don't know if you'd like to say something before we.
Thank you. Thank you, Tracy.
I just wanted to thank my board for being a part of this whole process. We had some really good applicants. And, of course, we can only pick one. So it was a very tough decision. But there was one that stood out above all the rest. And, of course, it was Shauna. And we did recommend to this board, and I really appreciate your support and our recommendation.
Is Shauna here?
She is here.
Oh, that's you.
Oh, that's you. I thought that was like your, some part of your family. Oh, okay. Well, Shauna is here. Okay, but before...
I trust your judgment. I think your board's very thorough, and you're all very thorough, so...
Yeah, thank you. I agree.
Yeah.
So with that, I will call.
David, can I just say something real quick?
Sure. Tony, come on up.
I'd like to say my
It's good. You can come on up. I know you're a member, the newest member of the board?
The newest, yeah. No. Myself.
I didn't say the youngest. I just said the newest.
No, I would also like, Tracy, I'd like to thank you guys for the support, too. It was a thing to go through. But, I mean, when we were all done, all three of us looked at each other, my friend Joni, Tracy, and myself, and without an exception, we chose the Shauna. Very, very good.
Okay. I would just say that I too, will ditto what Ms. McNamara has said. I respect your recommendation, and I'm sure that you went through the applications and the interview process fully and crossed all your T's, dotted all your I's, so I'm all set to go ahead and approve your recommendation as presented.
Thank you. So with that, I'll call for a motion that we appoint Shauna Geary of 169 Dublin Street, Somerset, Mass., as the new assistant to the Director for Council on Aging.
So moved.
Second.
By roll call vote, Mr. Moniz?
Aye.
Ms. McNamara?
Aye.
And I vote aye as well.
Congratulations.
Congratulations, Shauna. Congratulations. Good luck.
Congratulations.
They like to dance. Oh, were they? Yeah, I was dancing today. I was dancing with them today.
When I was injured, I saw them doing Tai Chi, and
I was
jealous.
Yeah, would you like to come up and say a few words? Yeah. Come on up, Sean. They said that you were like a little enthusiastic, and can you show us a few moves? Bonnie, put some music on.
I need to learn the Tai Chi. I have to get out there with them. But they were good at it. They were really good at it. I'd like to thank the opportunity to meet with you guys and Tracy and her board. And it was, I really look forward to serving the community. I've spent my whole career serving the elderly. I've worked as a nurse's aide, a PCA, good. You know, all different aspects. I sit on the board of directors for an animal shelter, and I really look forward to serving the town. I'm a townie, and I dig it. I'm really excited. It.
Congratulations and the best of luck to you.
Yeah,
you'll probably
thank you.
See me there on bingo days because I make an appearance every once in a while.
Bingo's a big deal. People
it
don't realize. Bingo's a big deal.
It can be rough crowd.
I worked
bingo.
At Clifton for years, and yeah. If you don't get someone to bingo on time, yeah.
Occasionally I'll go by and say hello and speak to everyone, and they'll ask me to call a couple of games. And if I'm too slow or too fast, they let me know it.
If you're not loud enough.
Yeah, if I'm not loud enough.
You got to be loud. You got to let them know.
Although things have changed now because they have a giant screen. They have a giant screen now on a timer, so things
yeah,
will be a
we like that. Everyone wants to see.
So I'll probably be seeing you, Gordon.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And good luck. Look forward to seeing you.
Dancing team.
Okay. All right. Discuss scheduling special town meeting and set date if ready. Richard?
Yes. We have consulted with the town clerk, and we've consulted with the high school on availability of dates. And we're recommending November 14th.
Okay. Does that work for you guys?
No.
November 14th, Monday.
Hold on a second.
What time are we going to have this? 6 o'clock?
Yes, we usually shoot for 6.
6.
I think 6 is what we shoot for, you know, so... More than likely, the time will be 6 o'clock. So we don't need to vote on it, do we, Clem?
Yeah, I believe you do.
Do we? We got to vote on everything. Can't just do it. All right, so I'll call for a motion that we accept the date as Monday, November 14th, for our special town meeting.
So moved.
Second.
A date to be announced, but it should be 6 o'clock.
Time to be announced.
Time. We set the date.
I'm sorry, the time. The time will be 6 o'clock. Hopefully, it should be 6 o'clock. So we have a second by roll call vote. Mr. Moniz?
Aye.
Ms. McNamara?
Aye.
I vote aye as well. So with that, announce a deadline for the citizens' petition articles and requests from department heads. We usually do that a couple of weeks before.
Well, the minimum time for articles from department heads is usually 30 days. You usually set citizens' petitions a week or two before that, so.
Okay.
So.
Basically 2 weeks from today from.
Right.
Citizen petitions and 34 department head.
So we want to do 2 weeks from today, which will be what? Is that the 7th? Do you have a thing on my calendar?
Yeah, you may want to go. That's the holiday weekend, so. It would be September 2nd.
So the end of the month?
September 2nd.
Oh, you want to do September 2nd?
2 weeks from today.
Okay.
September 2nd, is that what, citizens?
September 2nd. Why does that ring a bell?
That's for the citizens petition articles,
yes.
Gentlemen?
Yes.
One.
Why does that date not sound right as being a Wednesday? Oh, no, it's a Friday. That's why.
It yeah, so that'd be.
So then.
Which day again?
So it would be the end of the month, 31st. Would be for the citizens' petition. So we got 2 weeks from tonight. We want to do 2 weeks.
We usually give them to the, what, the end of the week?
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll go to the end of the week.
Okay,
so Friday's
fine. So citizens' petition would be September 2nd.
And then department head would be the 16th?
Yeah.
September.
Yeah.
16th of
September 16th. So I'll call for a motion that the deadline for citizens' petition will be Friday, September 2nd, and requests from department heads will be September 16th, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
I roll call vote, Mr. Moniz?
Aye.
I'm Ms. McNamara?
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. With that, we have topics not reasonably anticipated by the chair 48 hours in advance of the meeting. Are there any, Mr. Brown?
I have none.
No. Any old routine business task updates? I'll go ahead and say you have a couple.
I do.
Okay, good. You probably have more than a couple, but go
ahead. As you recall, during the appointment process at the for the annual appointments, you created a board of survey. Which was a new activity. We have met, and we have actually met and reviewed a property on Alberta Street and are recommending a demolition that will take care of a neighborhood concern that's been going on for a couple of years. You may recall we entered into an agreement to upgrade the boiler controls at Town Hall and Pottersville School. That has been done. There is now a computer interface on my desktop that allows me to adjust the boilers in both buildings. So in the event that we have an extended period of time where we may be closed down for a holiday, we can set the thermostats a lot lower. We can raise it for night meetings when it's a non-routine event. There's also an override within our building itself. Hazardous waste and community cleanup day. We serviced about 132 cars that day, so that was a good amount of activity. Route 6 RFP, we received one response that was deemed non-responsive. I've asked the people who received the RFP to comment on why they didn't get back to us. I have not received anything. I have gone through and made some revisions to the RFP process, and I will be reissuing that. We've met with, and Mr. Moniz was also part of this, and actually at his suggestion, met with Republic Services to talk about automating our collection of recyclables. And we're waiting for a proposal back from them on that. And it looks encouraging. We think we can bring it in at little to no increase in cost, and it will improve the quality of collection as well as make the community more attractive. So that's pretty exciting. The SEED Small Business Workshop is scheduled for the library on September 19th at 5 p.m. As SEED gets further along in their planning process, we'll get information out to you. I did tour the Quaker Meeting House with Rick Shane and was really impressed with the building itself and the dedication that that he and his group have to restoring that building, I have asked him to come up with a timeline of how the improvements would be. We keep talking about this being, you know, an $800,000 project, and it's so overwhelming, let's just not do it. It's not an $800,000 project. It is a series of smaller projects that'll get us to a goal. And as part of that, I've asked him to come up with some potential funding sources and how he would go about doing that. One of the things that I shared with Mr. Shane is that I was involved in a similar type effort back in several communities ago, back in the 90s. And that project is still going strong. It's still being restored. It probably is not much more improved than when I left there, but it is still ongoing. And it's a 1700s mansion. It will eventually get restored. And when it does, it will restore a building that could never be replaced. Not only the building itself, but the history that goes along with it. And I see the same potential for the Quaker Meeting House here. So rather than being overwhelmed with the work, I was pretty excited about the project. We have engaged with environmental partners to do our stormwater reporting. That's MS4 reporting and the updates that are required by the state and federal government. We have been working with environmental partners for a number of years on this same project. The regs have changed and gotten a little bit more involved, but it's still, you know, within the scope of what they can do for us. I did attend recently, and you probably saw it in the Fall River Herald, a meeting of the South Coast Development Partnership. The purpose was to discuss South Coast Rail. As you know, the Staunton route, which has been the preferred route, is going to be bogged down in cost and environmental issues. There is consideration of a Middleborough route, which may add 10 minutes or so to the runtime to get down to this area, but it would certainly accelerate the process for bringing rail into this part of the states. There will probably be some resolutions coming from the South Coast Development Partnership and or the Chamber of Commerce in Fall River. When those get here, they will be shared with us, and I will be asking the board to endorse those. I think it's a great way to move the project along. Some of this I'm just going to talk about. You've already seen it in the newspaper. We have some crosswalks that are now flagged. And I noticed that one of our board members was trying it out one day. this is a great example of something that was relatively no cost, taking some tubes and putting some flags in it, but a really creative idea by Brian Martin to increase pedestrian safety. He saw it work in another community, brought it back here. I don't know how effective it will be, but it's worth a shot. One of the concerns that this board has had has been pedestrian safety, especially crosswalks. So we're going to give it a try, and there's no reason why it can't work. I expect that for a while we may lose some of those flags because it's a novelty for somebody who may pass by there. And again, it's a low-cost item. We'll be prepared to replace those. The board had asked a while ago about enforcing regulations on the crosswalks. The police department did a sting. They did it over a couple of days. Day one, they made 32 stops. Day two, they made 41 stops. The first day, they issued 17 violations, and the second day, they issued 5, and there were warnings, both written and verbal, in both of those days. So I think that was a pretty effective effort, and we're going to have to follow up on that to make folks know that we're really serious about it. But I you know, I was just flabbergasted by the number. I expected we would get somebody. I didn't think we would make that many stops. But you run the street, I don't, so you're in a better position to see it. The hazard mitigation grant RFPs have been returned. We received 5. Those are being reviewed now, and I'll probably have a recommendation for an award in our meeting in mid-September. The Recreation Department had their senior cookout. You were all there. But what I came away from after being at that event is that that's just one of a series of things that happens in this community that involved the Recreation Department. It also involved the Council on Aging Director. But every one of those things is a community building event. And it's those things that happen that make our seniors feel like they're still part of the community and make everybody in the community feel like they're connected to one another. And you don't see that everywhere you go. And I think it's important that we recognize that and we remark on it, because I think it's what makes Somerset special. The boat ramp completion has been delayed. We're looking at the ramp opening about the 2nd of September. It looks like the dedication will be the that same day. The harbor master has asked if the board would entertain, once that ramp is open, waiving the daily fees for the rest of the year. We'll have a very short boating season after the reopening of the ramp. We're going to be closing it again for Spirit of Somerset. I think it's a modest thing we can do to say thank you for the patience the boating community has for that. So if no one objects, I will let him know that that's board's okay with that. And that is it. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. And we're going to go to other. I was going to give it to you first, but what I want to do is this is just something that I received, actually Richard Brown received, and this is from the Office of the Inspector General. You may think it's bad, but it's not. And I want to read just some of it, and this is going to kind of take off from why this gentleman here, our town administrator, is enabling us to have meetings once a month. As you can tell, he just went off and all kinds of tasks and all kinds of things that he's working on and he's doing and keeping us moving forward and keeping this community going the best it can be. It says, Dear Richard, congratulations. I am very pleased to inform you that our review committee has approved your qualifications for the designation of the MCPPO as of 6/30/2016. You are among a growing group of professionals to earn and receive a designation for your participation in the Massachusetts Certified Public Purchasing Official Program. Award of this designation demonstrates your commitment to excellence in public procurement. So basically what it is, and it's signed, there's more to it, but I don't want his head to get too big. It's signed by Joyce Emmett, who is the director. And basically what this says is that he has been certified and obviously designated to excel in our procurement process, which is everything that we do on our day-to-day operations, whether it's some of our the surplus items we have, or whether it is contracting to do work at the town hall or anything that's going on. So this is just a little acknowledgement, and I say little, but it's not. It's a big acknowledgement, and congratulations, Richard. Keep up the good work, and we really do appreciate what you're doing for us in this town. So thank you.
Thank you.
So with that, I have a few other things and other, but no, you're going first. I didn't let you talk in executive session, so go right ahead. No, you're going. Go ahead. Go. Or you're not going to get anything.
I love you.
Well, I just want to announce that I'll have office hours September 10th. 11 to 1 at the town hall. The last office hours are in June. I think two people showed up, and that's because it's summertime, I'm hoping. And so we didn't go in July and August. It was very, very hot, and people were on vacation. So we're going to pick up again September 10th, 11 to 1. And as always, the doors are open. Come in, say hello, complain, whatever it is that's your concern, or if you have any ideas to bring to me, and I will bring to my colleagues, that's fine. Mr. Brown has already discussed the crosswalks a little bit. I'd like to touch on them, as you saw my picture in the paper with the flag. The flags, again, I think it's a great idea. Our highway superintendent, Brian Martin, is to be credited with that. I did not come up with that idea. And again, it's to bring more attention to the pedestrian that's in the crosswalk. It's not to cure the problem. It's not to fix the problem. It's just another method in which we can identify as motorists that someone's in the crosswalk looking to cross the street. I tried it. It works. I stand out there. All you have to do is stand out there with the flag. You don't have to wave it above your head or side to side, just to stand out there with the flag. And for the most part, people stop. And as you can see, by the over the weekend, the past couple of days, our police department conducted a sting, a crosswalk sting or enforcement exercise, and Mr. Brown mentioned the numbers. They stopped in total 71 people. That's a tremendous amount of people, so there is an issue. There's a problem. It's ongoing. I brought this up for many, many meetings. As you know, I run throughout the town. You probably see me occasionally, and it's a problem. And hopefully, in conjunction with the crosswalk enforcement that was done and the orange flags that are now in place at certain locations in town, both motorists and pedestrians will feel more educated in what to do when approaching someone that's in a crosswalk. And the pedestrians will know what to do to get in the crosswalk. And I just want to say one last thing. As a pedestrian, in order for a vehicle to stop, you have to step inside the crosswalk. If you're standing up on the sidewalk, that means nothing to the, or should mean nothing to the motorist, that you could stand there all day long and drink a soda or a water. You have to be physically in the crosswalk, so that alerts the motorist that you're going to use that crosswalk to cross the street. Now, people have been lighting up social media with the whole flag idea. I mean, they're going to be taken. What do we do with the flags? Again, it's just a method, thinking outside the box, to bring more attention to someone that's in a crosswalk. So enough about the crosswalks. The other thing I want to mention is, and bring it to everyone's attention that is here in the room and that the folks that are watching at home, the town of Somerset does have a leash law for dogs. And the reason why I bring that up is because there are some areas in town that have signs clearly posted, dogs are not allowed. Now, I'm a dog owner, and I take my dog for a walk as often as I can, and she's on a leash. What I've been noticing and what people have been brought to my attention is that some folks are taking their pets to the cemeteries, taking them off leash and letting them run, play. And occasionally, the dog has been using that area as a bathroom. And the dog owner fails to pick up whatever's left behind. So I'd like to bring that to everyone's attention. I mean, it's tough to police courtesy and common sense. I understand that. But we ask that you adhere to the leash law. And please notice the signs that are clearly marked in the different locations in town that say dogs are not allowed. I would appreciate that very much. And the last thing I want to mention is the cookout. My colleagues, we were all there at the cookout. Mr. Brown was there for the Council on Aging. Tremendous event. He said enough about it already. I was slaving over the hot grill, cooking burgers for about an hour and a half. They must have enjoyed them because they all went. But it was a great time, and it's an effort by many departments in the town to make it happen. And the seniors enjoyed themselves. There was dancing. There was bingo. We had a great time. So kudos to everyone involved. And I'm done.
Thank you. Thanks, Mr. Morris. Holly?
Just a couple of quick things. A few people have pointed out that a lot of kids around riding bikes around the neighborhood haven't been wearing helmets. It's been a law for a really long time, but pointed it out on social media and caused a scene either direction, saying you're telling me what to do. I should be able to wear a helmet if I want or not, and also others saying thank you for pointing this out. It is a safety issue. So helmets do save lives. They saved my boyfriend's life. He'd be dead right now if he wasn't wearing one. So but it is a law. If you're 16 or under, you are required to wear a helmet, and you risk having your bike impounded for 15 days. So just a heads up. And then to reiterate Richard Brown's comments about the Quaker Meeting House. So as most of you know, I've been setting up these regular tours, and they've been growing. The first one was just me, and then I went again and brought about 10 people that were interested. And then the last one was this past Sunday. There were 75 people that responded, but I think about 40 ended up showing up. It was really hot that day, but they came, they stayed the whole 2 hours, and they all want another one, so I'm going to set up another one. I'm also helping Marianne McDonald and Rick Shane kind of start a, I guess you would call it, it's almost like the Friends of the Library would be, so Friends of the Quaker Meeting House and Somerset Preservation is what I think we're going to call it. I am by no means running the group. I'm just helping them starting, getting it started and you know, creating the buzz. So if anyone's interested in being a part of that, they're looking for anyone that's willing to volunteer time and put in some effort and working hours. They work really hard. It won't be a massive time commitment, but it's also a commitment to make sure that you do show up and help if you say you want to. So if you're interested, you can email me at selectmen@hollymack.com or my town email address is fine. So thanks.
Thanks, Allie.
Yep.
I just have a couple of things. One is, this is another letter. And I know that I have mentioned in the past that I, you know, I'm always one that tried to, you know, to highlight the goodness of things. Even if something's bad, I always think that something good comes out of it. And, you know, in town, we have a lot of people who do a lot of good things. And I know George just brought up someone, Peter Cabral, who has done so much for the girls softball over at Ashton Field. And I'd like to just commend him on all these years that he has been involved in just doing a great job in heading the girls softball league over at Ashton Field with all the improvements and everything else. I also have a correspondence here that I just want to summarize, but once again, it just shows, I think, what we're doing in this town, how we are all coming together, working together, and just getting things done. You know, there's no questioning. You know, I'm just really proud of all our departments. This one here goes out, it's actually to us. It just says, Dear David, I'd like to compliment you, Steve Monis, and Holly McNamara for the resident-friendly atmosphere you have established at the Selectmen's meetings. I came before the board last month to bring your attention the unsafe conditions of the sidewalks along Riverside Avenue. He said, you know, Brian Martin was here, and of course he's just basically going on saying how, you know, Brian Martin went out there with Fabian, our new our job foreman, took a look at it. We did the best we can. We're still working on, obviously, what we're going to do in the future as far as redoing Riverside Avenue. But this is from our resident, Bill Coughlin, who came in. And, you know, for somebody to take the time to write a letter and thank us and thank other departments is well appreciated. So, once again, it's all that collaboration of people working together. I'd also like to spill off on that. A lot of times we find in the media people always trying to pick up the negative things. Nice article by Michael Holzman in the Herald News. There's one of many. But one that really kind of hit me, which I know about, is the work that we're doing behind Little Audrey's, you know, between the Water Department, Bob Lehman, with the Highway Department, with Brian Martin, and also the private sector of what Bob Lehman's trying to do to get that area up to snuff. I know there's a problem with pressure, with volume. The roads are in terrible shape. Of course, we got to get the infrastructure done first before we can pave it. But once again, Bob Liam is doing a great job, as well as Brian Mott and the rest of the guys. But this was just a nice article about, once again, the town that's working together and teamwork and how we can actually save money and get more done, which is going to be better for the town.
One more thing. I forgot.
You got one more thing you forgot?
Yeah.
Oh, you want to jump in?
If you don't.
I wasn't. I was just going to mention the Spirit of Somerset. Of course, that's coming up. And you're going to watch out for that. But that's September 17th. And if anybody wants to donate, because I know people are giving out thousands of dollars, it'd be nice if you do want to donate or participate in the Spirit of Somerset. You're welcome to do that. Our next meeting will be Monday, August 29th at Teamworks at 6 o'clock. So I am done on the other.
Just one more thing. Sorry. So the Somerset Cultural Council had reached out to us requesting 1 to 2 new members on their board, and I'll just read what they had sent here. The Somerset Cultural Council is requesting that the Board of Selectmen appoint, now we're not appointing them right now, but we're looking for anyone that's interested to submit a talent bank application so that they can be considered at the next meeting. But anyway, Somerset Cultural Council is requesting that the Board of Selectmen appoint 1 to 2 new members. The Somerset Cultural Council is part of the Massachusetts Cultural Council, and quote, the LLC program is the emphasis on local autonomy and decision-making. Councils are free to make funding decisions that best meet the particular needs and priorities of their community within the parameters of the board's state guidelines. Each local council determines its own eligibility requirements based on community input process, end quote. Appointments can be up to 6 years, 2 to 3 year terms. Then there's a mandatory year off of the board. At this time, without any new appointments, they'll be below the required amount of members to be able to meet and distribute grants. So if anyone's interested in that and needs more information, I can get that information. That's all the information I have right now. But you can reach out to me and I'll put you in touch with them.
Okay. Is that all, Holly?
Yeah, that's it. Sorry.
Before we go to citizens' input, too, I do want to, now that I have everybody's kind of attention, is we, I have discussed this with Mr. Richard Brown, and our next selectmen's meeting is going to be September 21st. We're not going to have a meeting on September 7th. I've discussed this with Richard, and we, especially with the, I know Richard's going away on vacation. We also have Labor Day weekend. So we have everything in order, and we do not need to have a meeting on the 7th. So our next meeting will be the Wednesday, September 21st. With that, citizens' input. I want to remind everyone that there is a three-minute limit, and because I said that last time, so I want to adhere to that. If you have something on the subject matter, please remember 3 minutes is what you will be allowed to speak on. So first, Mr. Brown had his hand up first. He's almost had it up, so come on up, sir. Thank you for coming up. Thank you for being here.
Oh, yeah.
I haven't seen you in a while. You doing okay?
Great.
Trying to.
Are we going to accept that those two tanks from LNG over there for the $12 million or whatever we're supposed to get?
Right now, it's just a theory. It's just a thought. It has not come to fruition until they file with FERC. We might as well not talk about it because it may never happen. It's like you winning the lottery tomorrow. Let's discuss how you're going to spend it.
I
wish you did too. Yeah. Let's talk about how you're going
to
spend that money.
Yeah.
So once we find out, as soon as they file, I'm sure through our town administrator or somebody.
Go ahead.
No, I mean, you know, they may never file, so it may never even happen. So
we don't have enough information either.
Remember hearing at the meeting that they said, "Well, the town has been looked at already." So I figured maybe, you know, under the table there,
no
you know.
No under anything.
Yeah,
no.
Whatever they've done is they have done. But until they file, it's really not going to go any further than just a matter of words.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, now on for the power plant on the 17th, year 17, that's going to close completely, right?
So they say.
Well, I mean, is it going to be abandoned?
We don't know, Mr. Brown. And as soon as we know, we will let you know.
But I mean, I've heard of a lot of things, tearing down those big towers.
I know.
Well, those towers there represent a lot of taxes. So
I know that.
Don't give the money away yet.
I'm not the one to give it away. We need the money. So we're going to stay open and we're going to listen to whatever comes to us. But, you know, we don't know anything about Brain Point as of right now. It's basically, that's what they're saying. They're keeping all options open. And as soon as we find something out, we will let you guys know because we don't know anything different.
All right.
That's private.
My 3 minutes are up.
Thank you. That was good. I appreciate that.
Good job.
I'm going to have a gong. Next, Mr. Mullins. Come on up, sir.
First of all, I want to thank Mr. Mullins for his idea about the flags. I hope it works. But let me tell you the continuing saga of Mullins crossing the Buffinton. It's like George Washington crossing the Delaware. I did what you said. You had to be in the crosswalk. I started across. I looked up. This car was, I'd say, two or maybe three car lengths ahead. And I'm saying to myself, he's going to stop. He's going to stop. And all of a sudden, he ain't going to stop. And I'm in the middle of the, over the manhole. This guy's still coming. He stopped about that far away. I made a few comments using some phrases I learned when I was in the Navy, and I was tempted to reach him with my shillelagh and get him to court. I didn't want to go to court. This guy just looked blankly at me like this. I said, "Do you know that I was in the crosswalk and you were supposed to stop?"
Did you have a flag, Mr. Mullins?
With the flags.
Before the flags.
This is going to take that.
Right, so the flags are in place at your crosswalk.
You got to be in this line.
So you take the flag out. You take the flag out. You step in the crosswalk.
Right.
You put the flag in front of you. If you want to wave it, you can wave it. Look both ways, and then you cross the street. There's another holder on the other side of the street. You deposit your flag.
Right.
Okay?
I hope it works.
Now, with the crosswalk enforcement that we just had over the past couple of days,
and the, all the press coverage that it's been getting, we'll see what happens with people stopping.
Have you used it on Buffinton Street?
No, I've used it on Bourne Avenue.
I want to make another suggestion. I got the surprise of my life. A couple of days ago, I was coming up Buffinton Street about 8:30 sunset. That sunset is absolutely blinding. And I'm not, when I say blinding, I mean blinding. I had my dark glasses on. I had my thing in the car down as far as it would go. And for a few seconds or more than that, you cannot see with that sunset. It's blazing. I slowed down at 10 miles an hour to make my way up. When I say you can't see, you're looking at total sunset.
Mm-hmm.
It's absolutely blinding. It's a very dangerous situation, but I don't know what the cure is. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mullins.
Thanks, Mr. Mullins.
Right on time.
We pray for clouds at that time.
Yeah. Tony?
Three minutes.
Yeah.
Much less than that.
Goes.
Yeah. Quick three things. Holly, I want to really thank you for Friends Meeting House. I think that getting that tour going was just outstanding. To have the citizens really know what's in their backyard. So my kudos are really for you on that. Brian Martin, we need to talk about him. He's outstanding. From what I see him doing out in the roads as a citizen, driving around and stuff like that. And his crosswalks, Steve. He's done a great job. And the town rehab, Mr. Brown, excellent job on the town. You'd be amazed at how much the senior citizen says. Here they were talking about a brand new building. All we had to do was fix what we had. Kudos to you and our friend little Michael over there for doing a great job in town hall. It really, really makes that place look nice. So I want to thank you folks for that, because I know you guys hear a lot of negative, but it's good to hear positive sometimes too.
Thank you, Tony.
Thank you, Tony.
Thanks, Tony. Anybody else? Mr. Finglas? Joe?
Three minutes.
Three minutes.
That includes you walking over here, so you better start jogging. You're not there.
Not as old as you.
Tres minutos.
My name is Attorney Joe Finglas. I represent a lot of the retailers. My clients are here in the audience today. This is in regards to the recent tobacco control rules and regulations that were recently passed. I know that some of them received notice, but I don't think that they knew or were aware of the full breadth of the detail that was in the proposed regulations that were passed. What I want to go on record is that my clients fully support the Board of Health and the tobacco control laws and rules and regulations, but they take issue with only one item, which I'd like to bring before the Board of Health or the tobacco control at a future. It's one small section of the dealing with cigars.
Mm-hmm.
And I've looked at some extensive research over the past 2 or 3 days, and I believe it is unconstitutional, just that one little section. But like I said, we want to work with the board to make this a safe, proper environment for everybody in town, those that are legally allowed to purchase tobacco products. And we're looking to get on the agenda so we may fully flesh out and address these issues before the board. I have 17 retailers that pay over $2 million in taxes to the town. Their livelihoods are generated through not only living in town, but providing services to the town. They're a big part of this town. And like I said, we're not disputing 99% of the rules and regulations. We just want to address one specific rule and regulation, which we believe is unconstitutional. And we'd like to fully bring that before the board and actually have the tobacco control officer here. Matter of fact, I ended up finding that information. Put out by Regulating Tobacco Advertising Promotion, a Commerce Clause Overview for State and Local Governments, which is put out by Board of Health. And okay. I think it's just something that they might have missed. I mean, there's just so much to it. But I'd like to have an opportunity to come before the board and fully address this one particular issue. I'm not looking to invent the wheel again.
No, I understand, Attorney Finglas.
It's just that one section.
Yeah, is this the one to do with the pricing of single?
Yes.
Just so you know, it was brought up at the board's hearing, and the attorney that was there from the Mass Association of Boards of Health did respond. Apparently, the Boston tobacco regs have had that for a while, and it has been challenged unsuccessfully. But that said, I think what would be good is if you could submit your research to the board so that we could look at it prior to a meeting and then respond to it. I certainly will forward it to that attorney who testified at the hearing.
Well, I know, Clem, that, you know, being an attorney yourself, and no disrespect to the board, you're not attorneys.
No, I'm taking.
Underneath the Commerce Clause, underneath the Pike Test, the three-prong test, underneath the Pike Test, these pricing of the single cigars and the packaged cigars, when you start getting into packaging and pricing, it does not pass the third prong of the Pike Test. And that was an opinion put out by the Board of Health.
Which Board of Health?
This is put out, this is federal, this is a correspondence I found online today. Because of the fact, and the reasoning behind it, Clem, I can just review this real quickly, is because of the fact that when you ask a manufacturer of tobacco products to actually change its packaging, it was determined that the cost-effective health benefit did not substantially support the fact that a retailer would actually have to change his packaging specifically just to adhere to this type of a rule or regulation. Like Philip Morris or R.J. Reynolds, whatever tobacco producers are, that actually have to reprogram their factories in order to package specific quantities of cigars, and we're only talking cigars, in order to meet the local rule and regulation. And they found that the burden was too overly burdensome on these manufacturers, and it was struck down. I have all that information here, and I was shocked to see that they did that, but they said that it was just too burdensome. And a matter of fact, the way the town has written the rule and regulation, you're asking manufacturers of tobacco products to specifically tailor their packaging simply to support Somerset's rules and regulations. And that is unconstitutional underneath the Pike Test.
Okay, so I think what we can do, like I said, Joe, Mr. Finglas, we'll take it under advisement, get it to Clem, get it to us, and...
What I'd suggest is the board can set it up for a date to discuss it, but if you could get me the information, I can get the response of the person who testified at the hearing about that. Again, I believe her response was that in Boston it was upheld and that it was it did not apply for adult-only establishments. There was some distinction there, but in any event, I don't know the research, so,
I represent 120 of these stores in the greater New Bedford area. It did not pass in New Bedford, has not passed in Plymouth, has not passed in Framingham, has not passed in Swansea. What is happening is people are going to Swansea and just doing through the back door, buying all these products for the same price that they were selling at one time without this rule and regulation going into effect, and it is severely cut into their profits. Just this one particular item cut severely into their profits.
Again, we're talking about the single package cigars under
where you're maintaining, you can't sell singles and you got to sell packages of three for greater than $5, because now you're getting into dictating the cost.
The only thing I think we have is you can't sell any singles under 250. You can sell singles, but no. Yeah,
they got to be more than 250 and the multi ones got to be more than five. Two or more.
Any other packaging regs?
It says, no person shall sell or distribute or cause to be sold or distribute a single cigar. Number two, no person shall sell or distribute or cause to be sold or distribute any original factory wrapped package. That's where the problem comes in. Of two more cigars unless such package is priced for retail sale at $5 or more. Because now you're telling the factories, this is how you're going to package your product. And now you're telling the retailers, this is what you need to sell it for. You can't do that under the Commerce Clause.
Which section is that?
It's page 8, Clem, section F, cigar sales.
Yeah, I see it.
And also we take issue with the fact that it says no person shall sell, distribute, number one. Number two, it says no person shall sell or distribute. And then you allow others to sell and distribute, which is discriminating towards these people. Because then you allow a person or entity engaged in the business of selling or distributing cigars for commercial purposes to another person or entity engaged in the business of selling or distributing cigars for commercial purposes with the intent to sell or distribute outside the boundaries of Somerset. They can do it, but these people can't.
Yeah, but I also want to make it clear, Joe, and I appreciate you at this time, but, and I think I'm going to speak for, he, of course, Steve Monis is the chairman of the Board of Health, but we did vet the process. We did send out letters. I have a letter here that went to all of the vendors in town, and it clearly states that we were going to talk about prohibiting the flavored tobacco products as well as the sale of single cheap cigars. So that's what we were going to be talking about. We had a public hearing. Nobody showed up. Well, we can't say that. One person showed up, but she didn't say anything.
So there was no this side. These guys...
We got a letter.
And so I'm saying we, I just want the public to know, we've already done due diligence, we've done our democratic process, and now after we voted, because we only heard one side, Marilyn was here with her advocates, her lawyer, and everything that basically, you know, on her side, which of course she's trying to get everybody to stop smoking, and we are trying to help out, you know, these cheap cigars are because a lot of kids, teenagers, 18, 19-year-olds, are purchasing these because they're cheap and they're flavored. And so if we can help somebody not get addicted or wait a little bit till they're a little bit more mature to make a better decision about their health, you know, suggestions of what they're going to do with their health, that's what we heard and that's what we went by.
But I think that the letter was overly broad and vague in a sense.
It's not. It says it right there. I mean, it's pretty... Pretty
I think the regulation addresses a lot more than single cheap cigars.
Counselor.
I assume my talking doesn't cut into Joe's 3 minutes.
Yeah.
Thank you, Glenn.
No, don't worry about it.
Again, I would suggest if you could, Mr. Finglas, is put a memo together to the board summarizing what you got or attaching what you've got, and then we could take a look at it and then schedule a discussion of it. Again, those things were addressed at their hearing. I believe the response, there was a First Circuit case involving the city of Providence, and I believe it said that if you could restrict those things to adult-only stores, which the regulation does, it doesn't apply in adult-only stores because the goal is to prevent children from using those things, single cigars or flavored tobacco. And as I understand, you're just talking about the packaging.
And I'm very familiar with the First Circuit Providence case you're talking about. That was with the advertisement and promotion of cigars.
Yeah.
It's not with for the actual sale of the cigars.
Well, again, I don't know the research you've done, so it'd be helpful to have it. And what I will do is I will forward it to the person who testified at the hearing to get their response and let you know what that is as well prior to any discussion.
And I know that. I mean, these people are members of our community. They are retailers, they're taxpayers. I think they deserve and have an absolute right to come before the board and address any issues they may have with their businesses, with the town, with their selectmen that they vote for, that they put in office. And I think that they should have their opportunity to be heard.
I agree. And I want to make clear what I'm talking about is the legal argument. But
sure.
Putting that aside, I mean, it is a political decision of the board. The board has a right to adopt regulations, and it has a right to amend regulations. So
yeah.
that's something separate from lawyers arguing with each other.
Yeah, and I can assure you, we're only looking for the amendment to that one small section after I provide you with the information that I have.
Right. What I would say, Mr. Finglas, is that you provide the information to counsel.
Sure.
And then we'll have a chance to review it, and then we'll get in touch with you to set up a date specific and time so that you can come in more than 3 minutes.
Thank you, Selectman Moniz.
Before the Board of Health, which I am the chair of, and then we'll hear what you have to say representing your clients.
Perfect. I appreciate that. Thank you so much.
And we'll get back to you as soon as possible with a date, time specific as far as the hearing. It looks like
Ms. Edge ought to be there.
Exactly. So we can get everyone involved, present, so that any questions can be asked and answered at that time.
And I'll get something to you, Clement, ahead of time, outlining basically
what you've said.
What my information is.
Again,
that's perfect.
Our arguments are legal, but there's still, they have a right to petition you.
Right. I'm looking forward to listening to hearing what you have to say on behalf of your clients because we're not infallible.
And I understand we're looking to work with the board, the health board, the board of selectmen to make this a better circumstance for everybody who use tobacco products. That mean they really do a good job at monitoring who can buy, who can't buy, what they can sell, what they can't sell. And you know, we want as an ongoing working relationship to make this a better process for everybody.
I agree.
We're not here to be adversarial, or we're not looking here to change anything. We're just looking to revise that one small section.
So just submit the paperwork,
then we'll get together.
I'll stay open-minded.
Absolutely.
Yep. Because I know at the last meeting, Mr. Barraby, I believe it was you that said, you know, you would take a look at it another time in the future if some more information came available.
Yes.
And when they contacted me, I ended up finding this information.
That's fine.
Yep. Right.
I thank you very much for your time, members of the board.
Thank you, Mr. Finglas.
Mr. Brown, thank you very much for your time.
Time's up.
Thank you.
Only kidding, Mr. Finglas. Mr.
Is there anyone else? Citizens' input?
Mr. Palumbo.
He's not raising his hand.
No.
Nobody else is for citizens' input?
Mr. Barraby, I got one question.
One more, Mr. Brown.
Give me a minute. Now,
on those crosswalks, when you've got a red flag out there, right?
You can come on up, Mr. Brown.
Thirty seconds left.
Okay, after the 3 minute rule, you get a minute left.
You can't like carry over your time, you know.
No. I won't take that long, I'll tell you.
Okay.
On your crosswalks.
Yes, sir.
Like up in Maine, they have flashing yellow lights when you hit that button.
Yep.
Automatically. Why can't you do it here?
That's a great idea.
You got a sign.
I think.
When the lights are flashing, you must stop.
Mm-hmm. That's a great
idea.
It's
very easy to do.
I don't know who would pay for all the lights.
Yeah, it's open for discussion, but the flags are just a test, an idea. We're just kind of.
Well, I mean, you know, if I want to take a flag and then go out there and say, hey, I'm going to stop you.
Yeah.
Well, as long as you're in the crosswalk,
Yeah, well, I mean, I've seen the flags not on the crosswalk.
Yeah.
Well, the last thing we're going to talk about concerning the crosswalks, okay, as Ms. McNamara stated, it's a great idea. We're always open for further discussion concerning the crosswalks. But for time being, the flags are in place to see if it curtails the issue that we're having with the crosswalks.
Right. Now, the school up there, the high school, same thing. You have them at the high school when they're crossing that road. They stop.
And the last thing about crosswalks. Pedestrians. You are encouraged to use a crosswalk when crossing the street if one is any crosswalk that's nearest to you. Unfortunately, what we're seeing is people, for example, on the corner, I think Luther has a crosswalk, correct?
Mm-hmm.
At the high school. We'll use the high school because Mr. Brown brought that up. Instead of walking 5 feet to the crosswalk, people are just darting out onto County Street because it's a lot easier and quicker for them. Is that a violation of the law? Yes. So you've got to try to work with everyone. Use the crosswalks if they're nearby.
Mm-hmm.
Just don't dart into traffic.
I see it every day.
Okay, time's up, Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Brown.
Thank you.
The next thing, instead of a flag, you should have a shotgun.
Mr. Mullins.
Mr. Mullins.
I'd like to say that the treasury warrants have been signed. Once again, I want to remind everyone that our next meeting is Wednesday, September 21st. And with no further discussion, I'd like to call to adjourn this meeting.
So moved.
Second.
By roll call vote, Mr. Mullins?
Aye.
By Ms. McNamara?
Aye.
I vote aye as well. Thank you, everybody, for coming.